The following conversation, taken from CROI 2013, discusses the trial known as the Vaginal and Oral Interventions to Control the Epidemic, or VOICE study, as well as info on a study showing that the majority of HIV-infected adults in care are receiving recommended HIV services, but far too few are receiving services related to other STD infections.
Hello, this is Dr. Ron Valdeseri reporting from the 20th CROI meeting in Atlanta, Georgia, and I'm delighted to be able to speak with Dr. Jonathan Mermin, who's the director of the Division of HIV/AIDS Prevention at CDC. Welcome. At the meeting, we did hear about results from a large international trial to look at pre-exposure prophylaxis, or PrEP. And I wonder if, at a high level, Dr. Mermin, you can share with the viewers what you think that means in terms of what we know about pre-exposure prophylaxis and where PrEP fits into our overall prevention strategy.
So I'll focus my comments on oral pre-exposure prophylaxis. So taking PrEP daily in a pill to see if it will prevent HIV.
And these are among people who are not infected, but at high risk for infection.
Exactly. Okay. And there now have been multiple studies of that, both in the United States and internationally. And taken the most recent trial, the VOICE study that was presented at CROI this week, what we saw was that there was no effect among the two arms that actually provided people with oral PrEP. Whether with tenofovir alone or tenofovir and emtricitabine, which is a commonly used combination antiretroviral that is the recommended regimen for PrEP by the Food and Drug Administration. And when you look at that study alone, it's disappointing. But when you put it into the context of all the other different PrEP trials, it actually begins to tell us a story. And when we, when the researchers looked carefully at whether the women who participated in the VOICE trial were taking their medication as directed, they found that they were not. A very low proportion of the women actually had any detectable drug in their blood, and it lasts for a long time in the blood. So women who were in this study, where they didn't know if they were getting placebo or the study drug, actually did not take the drug enough, it looks like, to actually assess the true efficacy of pre-exposure prophylaxis.
And that's what, when the non-clinicians in the audience, when they hear us talk about adherence, that's what we mean, taking the drug as prescribed. In this case, it's PrEP, but it...
Exactly. And in the other studies that have been conducted, there's a very nice almost dose response with adherence and efficacy. So, for example, in... IPREC study among gay and bisexual men and transgender individuals, what they found was that overall there's about a 44% reduction in risk, but that for men who reported frequently taking their medication, it was a little bit more effective. And when they actually could detect drug in their blood, it was quite effective. And that was shown again in the PARTNER study, another PrEP study in heterosexual men and women, and again in a study of young women and men in Botswana. So what we're seeing is that at least it looks like a major issue for the efficacy of PrEP will be being able to take your medication as directed in a daily way. And that's hard. And I think that the research increasingly needs to focus on what things we can do as public health professionals and clinicians to help people adhere to their medication in a regular way, because it's not easy, and several studies have shown that it is one of the more important factors, if not the most important factor, for the efficacy of the medication.
Yeah. Thank you. And I think we'd want to remind our viewers also that adherence is an important issue for people who are already infected with HIV and are taking antiviral medication to suppress their viral load. And I know there have been a number of recent studies that show that some folks think because they're feeling better, they can stop taking their medication. And of course, this allows the virus to continue to reproduce, and it's not good for them, and it's not good for their partners. We know that many people living with HIV are young and of reproductive age and sexually active, which means that they can acquire other STDs. Can we just remind folks about the importance of that and talk generally about the intersection between HIV and other sexually transmitted infections?
So Dr. Jacek Skarbinski, who oversees the Medical Monitoring Project, a nationally representative surveillance system of people with HIV in care, presented this week data that shows that among people in care, they're receiving good care, clinical care.
For HIV disease.
Absolutely. And many also are receiving preventive messages about how they can not transmit HIV to their partners. But what they also found was that a small proportion were actually receiving regular routine screening for other sexually transmitted diseases like chlamydia and gonorrhea and syphilis. And that's an important recommendation that both CDC and others have for clinical providers for people with HIV, because both they're at risk from their sexual activity for acquiring those infections, but also that having another sexually transmitted disease. So it's an integrated program. We need to make sure that people with HIV receive the necessary screening and treatment that's going to benefit them and their partners.
Sure. So being treated for HIV does not protect against other STDs.
No.
And I think that goes back to some earlier conversations that we had about the importance of consistent condom use, consistent and correct condom use. So I want to thank you for your time, for sharing your excellent perspectives with the audience. And we'll look forward to learning more about the scientific findings coming out of CROI in Atlanta. Dr. Mermin, thank you so much.
Thank you, Ron. It's always great to talk with you.